topic is when to say no to stent in coronary artery disease by Dr. V.Prabhakar. Graduate from Tanjore Medical College and MS from and MCH from CMC Velo, assistant professor in cardiology, MMC Chennai from 2013 to 2014, associate consultant in main Apollo from 2015 to 19, and as a consultant cardiothoracic surgery in main Apollo from 2019 onwards.
Good evening to all of you. First of all, I thank IRB Kodambakkam branch for giving me this opportunity. This I'm going to tell briefly some clinical situation where all the physician faces when their patient or relative comes and asks about the coronary artery disease. Some of our relatives, friends, or patients will come and complain. We come and tell we have some chest tightness or some uneasiness in the chest while walking for the past few days or few months. Then we may think of coronary artery disease and the general practitioner, general physician will take ECG. The ECG may show some signs of ischemia or may be normal. Then the physician will refer the patient to the cardiologist to rule out the coronary artery disease. The cardiologist will do the echo. Echo may be normal or will show some regional wall motion. If it is normal, then the cardiologist will ask for stress test, treadmill test. If the treadmill test is positive, that indicates there are areas of inducible ischemia in the myocardium. So, the cardiologist will go to coronary angiography next. After the coronary angiography, the cardiologist will tell the patient, you have one block, two block, or multiple blocks. Then the patient will bring the angiogram report to the physician. In that situation, how to guide the patient, that thing only I am going to tell. Before going to the proper, I want to tell in coronary angiography, we use terms like single vessel disease, double vessel disease, triple vessel disease, or multiple vessel disease, and left main disease. What is this? Coronary artery anatomy is like that. Left side of the heart, that is the left ventricle, is supplied by the left coronary artery. The left coronary artery divides into two major branches. One is left anterior descending artery, which goes into the anterior ventricular group. Another one is left circumflex artery, that we call is LCX, that goes into the left AV group. Another one is right coronary artery, that supplies the right ventricle, most of the right ventricle, and some part of the left ventricle also. So these are the major branches, these LAD, LCX, RCA, these are all called major arteries. If one of them is diseased, that is called single vessel, two major vessels are diseased, that is called double vessel, if all three vessels are diseased, we call it triple vessel disease. Left coronary, before bifurcation, the main part of the left coronary is called left main coronary artery. That stenosis we will call it as left main stenosis. So the patient comes with coronary angiogram report. How will you guide them? So most of the time the cardiologist will tell you have to go for stenting. Whether they have properly guided the patient or not, that thing only I am going to tell you. In coronary artery disease, the spectrum is like that. Everyone knows what the history which I said before is the stable angina, that is called stable coronary artery disease. The coronary artery disease which presents acutely, that is called the acute coronary syndrome, that includes unstable angina, non-ST elevation MI and ST elevation MI. Among these, the unstable angina and non-ST elevation MI are caused by acute subtotal occlusion or partial occlusion of the coronary arteries. The ST elevation MI occurs when the coronary artery is totally occluded. In stable coronary patients, which I said before, they undergo angiography, they come with the angiogram report. First, you have to see which vessel is, how many vessels are, major vessels are. Next. How many major vessels are involved? Whether single vessel or two major vessels. Among these single or two vessels, if there is the LA involvement, is there or not? If LAD is involved, then you see which segment of the LAD. There are proximal, mid and distal segments. If the proximal segment is involved in the LAD, surgery is the best treatment. Because there are many studies which compare proximal LAD lesion, patients undergoing for surgery. Surgery means lima, left internal mammary artery to the left anterior descending artery. That is the gold standard for coronary artery bypass surgery. This lima to LAD grafting, they have compared lima to LAD grafting with stenting the proximal segment. When they compared, the repeat revascularization rate, long-term survival were much better for coronary artery bypass grafting. Some recent days, the cardiologists are claiming the newer drug-eluting stents, which gives patency rate equal to the lima to LAD. But they are all quoting only for 5-10 years. But when you take the studies which compared lima to LAD, studies which followed the lima to LAD for more than 20 years, that has good patency rate. So definitely for proximal LAD lesions, either single vessel or double vessel, surgery is the best option. Next, if the patient has all three vessels are blocked, triple vessel disease. If the patient is diabetic, there is no question, they have to go for surgery. You can suggest boldly, you have to undergo surgery, no stenting. Then if the patient is non-diabetic, then there is some scores. What is that syntax scores means? According to the anatomical characteristic of the lesions, that include which segment of the coronary artery, either proximal, mid, distal, LAD or circumflex, and then which branch involved. The major coronary arteries which I said has some side branches. LAD has diagonal branches, circumflex has obtuse marginal OM branches, right coronary has acute marginal branches. Whether this disease involves the major coronaries or side branches, whether the lesion is in the bifurcation or trifurcation sites, whether the calcium is less or more, according to so many variables are there, each one has some score. Finally, when they calculate, if the score comes more than 22, even in non-diabetic patients, surgery is the best treatment. Another thing, when the score is less than 22, what they are quoting, they followed up in the recent study, they followed up the patients. One group, surgery, another group, stenting. So, when they followed up for a few years, or up to three years, they said that surgery as well as stenting comes equal percentage of pregnancy. But it is not above, almost equal to the surgery they are saying, but not equal to or superior to the surgery. So, in this case also, we can consider surgery even when the syntax score is less also. Another, when there is an involvement of left main coronary artery, definitely surgery is the option. So, when I put it, in stable coronary artery disease, in addition to the diabetes mellitus, if the patient's LV function is less, there also surgery works better than stenting or medical therapy. When the patient has a contraindication to dual antiplatelet therapy, the bleeding complications or something prevents the patient taking double antiplatelets, then surgery will be the good option. Because if you stent, they have to take dual antiplatelets for at least 1 year. Then, as I said before, the multivessel disease and severely calcified coronary arteries, better to go for surgery only. If the patient needs some other concomitant procedures like valve replacement, they should undergo surgery only. Next, I come to the acute coronary syndromes in unstable angina and non-ST elevation MIs. If the patient acutely presents with chest pain, we are suspecting unstable angina or non-STEMI, the patient will undergo coronary angiography. If the angiography shows single or double vessel, as I said before, we have to see the LAD, whether the proximal LAD is involved or not. Then we have to suggest surgery. Left main disease is there, then surgery. Triple vessel, diabetic, again surgery. So, various studies confirm the multivessel disease and left main disease in non-ST elevation MI. The 5-year primary outcomes like death, MI and strokes are significantly lower in CABG group compared with the stent group. Then, as I said before, diabetes and multivessel disease in diabetics, CABG gives greater benefits than stenting. Next, I come to the STEMI. STEMI, when they present within 6 or 12 hours, primary PCA is the treatment of choice nowadays. If the patient is unsuitable for PCA, like the unsuitable coronary anatomy, then they have to undergo emergency CABG. If the patient presents with MI complications, like acute ischemic MR, ventricular septal rupture, ventricular free wall rupture, then surgery is the treatment of choice. So these are acute conditions. When you come to the chronic heart failure conditions, the patient, this is called ischemic cardiomyopathy presenting with cardiac failure. The patients may present with angina or dyspnea. If the patient has angina, that indirectly indicates that he has viable myocardium, he will benefit from the surgery. But if the patient presents with only complaining of dyspnea, then we have to find out whether there is a viable myocardium or not. For that, we should do stress thallium scan. That will show whether there is a viable myocardium or not. If there is a viable myocardium, then we have to see how many percentage of viable myocardium is there. If the viable myocardium is more than 20%, then the patient will get benefited by revascularization. So in that case, CABG will be much better than the stenting in severe AV dysfunction with viable myocardium, and if he is a diabetic, more so. The CABG significantly lowers the risk of MACE, means major adverse cardiac events, which includes cardiac death also. That is significantly lower in CABG groups, and these people, long term survival benefits are more. I have already mentioned diabetic patient, most of the time the surgery is the best chance for them. What is the problem in diabetic patients? They will have mostly left main disease and multivessel disease with diffuse involvement of the coronary arteries, and the disease will involve even smaller vessels. So diabetic patients, mostly they will prefer, surgery will be better for them. Thank you. Any questions?
Post-operative morbidity mortality, hospital stay.
surgical cost is lesser than the stent. If you put two stents, they will charge more than 3 lakh, 3.5 something. We can operate within 3 lakhs or so. So, CAB. Another thing, if you put stent for one vessel, two stents, then we have other lesions also. Initially, the cardiologist will say they are all insignificant, we can manage with drugs. If that becomes significant, they need another stent, that cost will be more. If it is not so, if they have to undergo surgery, then cost will be doubled. So cost is not the problem in CABG. Another thing, postoperative complications. Postoperative complications are there, but wound infection complications are all 1 to 2%. If it's a rare body, 3 to 4%. So if we control perioperative diabetic control, if you control the sugar level less than 150 like that, the wound complication also will be less. If you compare the long-term survival benefit, these are all short-term benefits. Stenting, there is no infection, only stent is placed, no invasive incisions or something. But long-term you have to see, if the patient's repeat revascularization and then long-term survival benefits are more with CABG only. Initial time they have to suffer the post-operative pain for 1 or 2 months. After that they will do better than the stenting patients. Yes, that's why I am telling you, when the patient comes to you with the report, you can guide them properly. Generally, there is no statistics right there. What I feel, most of the patients goes for sending because the patients are not coming directly to us. So the cardiologist should decide whether he has to go for sending or surgery. Another thing, the patients are all worried, scared about invasive procedures, cutting the sternum, big surgery, big post-operative, we can't do anything like that. They are already scared. So for them, when the cardiologist say, you can undergo, if definitely surgery is needed, even all the, as I said, all the lesions are better dealt with surgery. But the cardiologist will say, you have to undergo surgery, but we can put these two stent, another one lesion we can manage this medically also. Then the patient will choose stenting only because they are afraid of surgery. So they are not thinking long term benefits. Even in recent trial, they have misinterpreted the results. So for left main disease, 3 years or the third year follow, they presented the stenting and CABG are same benefits, the complications, morbidity, everything same. But when they follow up for 5 years, the left main stenting patients had significantly higher mortality. But they didn't present the 5 year results. They will present only the third year results and will inform you also, general practitioner, at the third year, the stenting in left main also better like that. So they will hide the truth at the fifth year. So like that, so many hidden things are there. Unless you are well educated, well clear, as your clarity, according to your clarity only, they can change.
CAB done in
speaking part? Yes sir, we do 99% is beating heart only. If the patient doesn't tolerate the beating heart positioning and all, we will go on pump and will not arrest the heart. On pump, we will do the grafting. That is called on pump beating heart. So arrested heart is we are not doing in Apollo regularly. Actually, I was trained in arrested heart, on pump arrested heart. After my post-graduation, I have never seen the on pump arrested heart CABG. We do only beating heart. Everything is being done, but we don't have the long-term results. We are doing minimally invasive surgeries will be best for a single graft. We can open through the small left thoracotomy and harvest the mammary and anastomose to the LAD. These are all easily we can do it, but multiple vessels, many surgeons are all claiming, but I don't have my personal experience because that will be difficult. We have to follow for long time, then only the pattern C of the graft and the long term benefits we can know. Till then, initially after doing one or two cases, just publishing will not be the good thing.
Modern robotic
surgery? Yes, everything is same only. Robotic surgery, we won't do everything by robo. We will harvest the mammary through robo. After that, everything through opening the thoracotomy, we will do everything by hand only. We will harvest the mammary because everyone will think robo will do everything, even anastomosis, everything through the robo sand. That is not there. So, unless you go into the detail, you will be cheated by so many fancy things.
Thank you, sir.
That we know as the so that chelating drugs they will inject through the IV, thinking that this IV chelating agent goes through the coronaries and absorbs the calcium in the blocks and releases the calcium. These things already tried during our initial times of coronary artery treatment, but they are not successful. That's why that was abandoned. Now we are in the recent era, advanced era. In this era, if somebody goes there, the results and advantages of that chelating agent is very, very minimal compared to the other recent stenting and the CAD surgery. So that is not recommended. So patients are all uneducated, sometimes educated people are also going. Another one is that EECP. EECP is external counter pulsation therapy. That is works like IABP mechanism. IABP means external counter pulsation means they will put arm, legs, everything, some what do you call for inflation, deflation balloons.
Cups.
When the balloons inflate, that will push the blood into the towards the heart. And then that will increase the peripheral vascular resistance also. When it relaxes, there is a reduced SVR, systemic vascular resistance. In IABP mechanism also same thing only. What we will put the balloon into the artery. Artery means the descending thoracic aorta. The balloon will inflate during the diastole period. During the diastole only, the heart will get the blood supply, diastolic time. Myocardial effect. During that time, the balloon will inflate in the descending thoracic aorta. So, that will push the blood towards the coronary during diastole. So, the diastolic coronary flow will be augmented by the balloon inflation. So, more blood, myocardial receives the more blood, so the ischemia will get relieved. Another thing, when the heart contracts systemic, the balloon should be deflated. That time, the peripheral vascular resistance comes down, the heart ejects easily into the systemic circulation. That is called systemic increases the cardiac workload. Diastolic augmentation of the pressure, systolic reduction of the systemic vascular resistance. In this mechanism only, IABP works. The same mechanism also works for the EECP. That increases the blood flow to the heart some amount, reduces the peripheral vascular resistance in this mechanism. This will be useful for when the patient already undergone surgery, all the vessels bypassed. Vessels. After that, still they have some chest pain. There is no target vessel to graft again. In that situation, there is no other way, they have to increase the medications. When the medication dose is increased, still they have pain, then they can try for the EECP. That will augment the diastolic pressure and increases the coronary perfusion. One. Another thing, primarily first time patient is coming to the cardiologist doing angio. Everywhere diffuse cirrhosis, like diabetic patients usually they will have. There is no place to stent also. If you want to graft, there is no place to graft. Everything is diseased small, small vessels. Then we can suggest them to go for EECP. These are all the conditions we can suggest EECP. That is also approved in FDA in US. For these conditions, it is approved. Other than this, normal patients, young patients, good coronary anatomy, vessels are stentable or graftable. In this situation, if you go, that is detrimental only. That is then. Nowadays, surgical mortality is very less, 1-2% only. When you compare the previous days, in the olden days, it was very high. So, with this 1-2 mortality, you can live a good, long quality of life later. You can accept this 1-2% and undergo surgery. Then you can learn the, your quality of life will be better. So these two things only. So nowadays, these two has no role, unless in specific situations. I don't know about sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now, for
sir.
Sir.
Complications of surgery and things like that.
Okay.
With the comorbidity is better is what I
what I am telling is that one thing you have to, you should understand, the collaterals is not opened by the high pressure. Collaterals already is there normally, it will open, nature has given. Whenever there is a block, some other collaterals should supply, will try to supply the area. This collaterals is not opened up by the EECP. That will develop even if you are not undergoing EECP, the collaterals will develop.
That will develop only when in old patients, but it has been proven that
collaterals is not as when there is a block, already coronary artery block is there.
Yes.
Heart will, the nature will try to overcome the block by developing collaterals.
Yes.
But that is trying, not going to correct the block. That is trying, but that will not give the needed whole blood. Initially that will try. That is not enough when you are exerting, when you are doing exercise. That's why you develop chest pain. Otherwise, you should be normal only like collaterals. Block is there, collaterals develop, you can do the work as usual, but that tries to compensate the ischemia, but that is not enough. So the EECP also, whether you undergo EECP or not, collaterals will develop. That will, when you push the blood, there will be some increased blood flow, I am accepting. That's why the angina pain in patients whom I said, the diffusely disease, already twice, thrice operated patients, now there is no conduits, no place to graft. In that situation, this increased blood supply relieves their pain some amount. So, EECP is not increasing the collaterals, that develops naturally.
Thank you.
So, no need to.
Just to add, we know for sure that CABG and stenting augments the coronary blood. So, that's very simple physics. So you're putting big tubes to proximal coronary blood. If you use nature, then you don't have targets. Then you have to do something to the patient. So, one thing is like, you try this. It's not a proven thing. It's only it doesn't have the evidence base that maybe myocardial revascularization by CABG or stenting has. The other problem that I would like to point out at this point is we have had quite a few patients with the diffuse disease, severe liver dysfunction, gone for EECP, presenting an impression with pulmonary. So it has to be coupled perfectly during diastole, it should inflate, during systole, it should deflate. So when that is not done, most often the EECP is done by non-trained people without adequate support. And we have had one, there's one place in ECR, from where my brother-in-law runs a place on ECR, he's a cardiologist. He gets routinely patients with pulmonary edema. So you have to take it with a pinch of salt. But when options are not there, we explore it, I think. And that way it has a definite role.
Yes, as far as I have seen, few patients dying after EECP, that they have to synchronize with diastolic augmentation, systolic relaxation. If they are not doing, that will worsen the symptoms, that the heart will fail and suddenly they will go for cardiac arrest.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now, Dr. Yes, I will. Appreciation.